I look at the gap between what researchers know on tsunamis and how myself, my colleagues, and friends and neighbors live and behave here on the Oregon coast. It can't help but increase the passion. It's a real tall order for education. People want to live and move right up next to the edge of the beach, and that's our human nature, but then they have to deal with the waves that come and disrupt their property. These are just natural processes that go on, and we have to take care to respect the fact that the beaches move, that tsunamis occur, and we need to adapt our lifestyles to the natural physical phenomena, because they're not going to stop just because we bought property here. What I do is bridge the gap between what the researchers know about coastal hazards and how we on the coast behave and live our lives and develop our communities. For example, in Neskowin, they're getting a lot of coastal erosion and water coming over the riprap rocks into people's living rooms. Is it going to get better? Is it going to get worse? And if it's going to get worse, what can we do, you know, to mitigate the problem? So coincidentally, Peter Ruggiero, faculty at Oregon State University, was doing research on coastal erosion and shoreline change and actually monitoring the beach in that area. So we arranged to have Peter and graduate students come and show the latest research showing the trends. And now they're going through the process of winnowing out what will work for them in Neskowin. Our neurology evolved to be afraid of lions and tigers and bears jumping out on the path in front of us. So climate change related impacts are not a direct passion to us, nor are 300-year recurrence interval events. But what research has shown us recently that has gotten my attention and my passion is our vulnerability to the Cascadia subduction zone earthquake and resulting tsunamis. We get what Japan got. One of the findings of the research from the Japanese experience is that people who drilled evacuations made it to safety. If you intellectually know where you're supposed to go, but you never sort of go there, it could be at night in the rain, and you may not know about the way to get there or the way that's blocked to get there. It's very tough to get people during a working day to leave their desk and go run up a hill. And it sounds silly even just saying it, but when you realize that that practice will save your life or the life of your child, one more silly thing that might save your life isn't a big problem. It's kind of guerrilla education. It's sort of less formal workshops and more becoming involved in local groups and activities and having that local presence to monitor what's going on. This group of people back here, we are right here, we are right now, and we feel the beginning of an earthquake, and it ain't stopping. What do you do and why? Discuss amongst yourselves. When is that teachable moment? When is the threshold of interest to the point that they're ready to use the science? Doesn't do any good to be too soon with the science, and does no good at all to be too late with the science. So it's a matter of being that broker that can have a sense of the issues and the timing and bring them together at the right time and be persistent. And oftentimes that can be a challenge.